three speakers in this session. In this session, we will have three very experienced speakers who will talk about their projects. We will have Irina Vlasenko from Ukraine. We will have Danielle McVicar from Canada. And we will have Cristina Petrut from Romania. They really deserve applause because of their projects. And from their experience, you can learn a lot. You can learn how to plan a project, how to find the finance, how to conduct the project, and how to present their project afterwards. So it is my pleasure to invite you to give us a presentation. The first presentation will be by Danielle. So Danielle, please, can you share your experience with us?
Yeah, thank you so much for letting me talk with you folks today. I know a lot of people here run their own diabetes camps in their own country, so this is just talking about my experiences and my perspective of running diabetes camps in Canada. I know camps are different all around the world, so please take into consideration that this is from the Canadian perspective, have you will, for running summer camps for kids living with type 1 diabetes. So first off, I just want to say a few things of why diabetes camp. Why is it important? So with our programs with Diabetes Canada, we have three major goals or outcomes of why we believe that diabetes camp is important for kids living with diabetes. So first off, in Canada, they say there are the same number of kids living with type 1 as there are elementary schools. So to put that in simpler terms, there may be one kid in each school living with diabetes. Obviously, that's not the case. Some schools have four schools may have none. But just to show a representation that most of our kids that come to camp, they're the only ones in their schools, their communities, their sports teams that live with diabetes. And camp is a unique opportunity for them to connect and meet other kids living with the same thing that they're living with. So our number one kind of goal or outcome is to build that sense of community so that kids don't aren't feeling as isolated as they would have if they've never come to camp. And then one of our second big goals is to participate in outdoor activities that promote self-esteem and growth. So we try and run our camps just as any other ordinary camp. If you didn't live with a medical condition and went to a summer camp in Canada or the US, they try and promote the self-esteem and growth by just by doing the activities, pushing your limits in what those activities may be, and doing some leadership activities and team building ones too. And then our third one is to teach, promote, and encourage independent self-management of diabetes. And in Canada, we're really fortunate enough to have a pretty great healthcare system and a very supportive diabetes healthcare system, but camp is a great opportunity for our kids to see those doctors, those healthcare professionals outside of the medical setting. And then also it's great for them to learn from their peers and from their role models about their diabetes management. So most of our campers at camp, the first time they've given themselves an injection might have been at camp, the first time they understood carb counting might have been at camp, and so on and so forth. And we kind of try and teach that by a community and an organic environment. So if you know a group of 10 8-year-olds are in the same cabin group and some of them have never given their own injection, but others may have, those curious kids, they work in a peer-based learning environment. Next, I'm gonna show a video that Diabetes Canada, which was formerly called Canadian Diabetes Association, so that's why it says that in the video. They did a series on Banting, the discoverer of insulin, and about his legacy in order to promote funds for Diabetes Canada. Back then it was called Canadian Diabetes Association, and it just shows the importance of camp.
I play hockey, so I tested 4 games.
like this.
I play hockey, so I test before games, during games. When I'm low, I have to get off and test my blood and stay out for a while.
Camp changed his whole life. His dream is to work at one of the camps in the future as a counselor, and he's just become a real advocate for type 1 diabetes.
After only spending 5 days at camp, she came home feeling very convinced that she was ready for the pump. So just seeing that sense of autonomy for her to make that choice on her own after 5 years of a lot of indecision, that really made a huge difference.
You know, I learned a lot about how other people deal with it, and especially the little kids. They were talking about at Halloween how, you know, they got to eat a certain amount of candy and how they took care of themselves. And it was, you know, I learned a lot from other people and how they handle it.
I'll go back to Camp Toronto because that experience left me feeling that I could do anything, that there was nothing that having diabetes would prevent me from doing.
So Detour is an event that we host for 15 to 18 year olds. We talk about things like transitioning into adult care, moving out on your own, and the challenges you may face as an adult. So things change from pediatric care to adult care, but it's really about being your own advocate and moving on with your life, but giving you the tools in order to do so comfortably.
I do know that he's the creator of insulin, and I think it was around 1920 that he invented it.
He made insulin, and you know, he basically saved all diabetic lives by making it.
If he never invented insulin, I wouldn't have been here, right?
Yeah, if Preston didn't have insulin, he wouldn't be with us here today.
Essentially, I'm here today having this conversation because of him.
There, you did it. Good job.
So yeah, Diabetes Canada made a series of videos about our programs and our research that we do about Banting's legacy to help promote funds for our organization. So just a little background on what we do in Canada. So Diabetes Canada runs a national camping program called D-Camps, and we run 12 summer camp programs across the country. They all have unique names and unique histories. These are all of their logos. And we also run 10 family camp programs, which are weekend programs that are for any families affected by diabetes. And then we have 10 leadership development programs, which are for youth between the ages of 15 to 17. And we teach them skills that one day they can become camp counselors at our programs. So in my work with Diabetes Canada, I was responsible for running all of these four camps, so about half the country, and saw about 600 kids every summer through those programs, either 1 week or 2 week programs. So next, I just want to do an overview of some things that kind of I thought about, or you might be thinking about if you're running your own diabetes camps. So the first and probably biggest one that all of you may be dealing with would be funding and promotion. So how do you get the funds to run these programs? In Canada, our camp programs cost the organization in expenses about $3 million, and we only bring in $1 million. So a lot of work from our fundraisers to make sure that camp is possible. But something that the camp staff did is we made sure that camp was measurable and that we could show the impact of camp. So that means we had lots of surveys after camp happened to show, you know, if a kid comes to camp, their life is improved and what that looks like in terms of their A1C or their health or their mental health. And then the next thing that we that you have to do is, how do you know about camp? Who's going to go to camp? So we promoted our camps through our children hospitals, so our diabetes clinics. We had marketing materials for them, and then our doctors and nurses that actually come to camp are big advocates to get all of our kids to camp. I know some countries have diabetes registries, but Canada does not, so that was the avenue that we took to promote our programs. And another thing I just want to talk about, funding and the expense of camp. We believed in Canada that every child living with type 1 should have the opportunity to go. So we had a three-tiered pricing system. In our budget, it costs the organization about $3,000 a week to send someone to camp. And you had three options to pay. So the highest fee was about $900. The second highest was $800, and then the lowest was $600, and it was an honor system of what families felt like they could afford to pay, and then they could also donate on top of that, understanding how much it cost. If the lowest tier was a challenge for families, they could then apply for further subsidy through us, which we granted about $200,000 a summer for kids that did not have the funds to come to our programs. The next thing to think about is the medical support and systems. So we were fortunate enough to have really good relationships with all of the children's hospitals in Canada, and our camps were made up of medical directors, head nurses, and head dietitians that created a committee for each camp, and those committees communicated with all of the other committees across the country to figure out systems and ideas of, you know, how do you treat a hypo blood sugar at camp? How are you dosing your kids at camp? How are you dealing with nighttime checks at camp? All of that support and those systems all came from our medical staff. And something that was important by that is they are the ones advocating for kids to come to our programs. So our parents really trusted that it was a medically safe camp, so our doctors really ensured that it was. But at camp, something that was really unique about some of our camps is that the doctors felt like it was a great teaching opportunity. So yes, there would be the head dietitian from the local diabetes children's hospital, the head nurse that's a diabetes educator, and the medical director that was a pediatric endocrinologist. But we also had tons of residents, nursing students, general nurses and dietitians that don't necessarily work in diabetes, but it was a great opportunity for them to learn about what it's like to work in diabetes and what that actually looks like from a patient perspective, as opposed to what they're reading in the textbook. And even at some of our camps, our medical directors would have their residents or their medical students to be wearing an insulin pump all week or to dose themselves all week on saline to really understand what it would be like to live with diabetes. The next thing that is important to run camp is the ability to have staff so that they can actually run it and that type of training. So we are fortunate that we had a leadership development program at most of our camps. So a lot of our kids that went through the system then one day would work at camp. And our reasoning for this, or our goal for this, was that as a kid, most of these campers feel like their counselor is the coolest person in the world, regardless of if they are or not, and they really look up to them as role models. So to have those people living with the same disease that they're living with is so much more empowering. So we really believe strongly in hiring people that went through our program, hiring people that lived with type 1, and hiring people that were strong role models in that way. But we would do at least in my region, we would hire camp staff for the entire summer. So we would hire them for eight weeks. They'd work at four camps, and we'd run a week-long training program for them so that they could be the best counselors possible. In that training program, we dealt with first aid, children behavior, risk management plans, what diabetes is at camp, because they live with diabetes and have their own way of managing it, but at camp we had specific guidelines, so we had to teach our counselors on that. And another big thing that we always talked about with our staff was language and what type of language they used in front of their campers. So something that I felt strongly about and always talked with my staff about was things like using the term diabetic. A lot of my staff, you know, identified as being diabetic or had tattoos on their body saying diabetic, but at DCAMPS, we like to promote the fact that if you live with diabetes, you can be whoever you want to be first before you are that disease. So we really promoted the language of living with diabetes as opposed to the word diabetic. We also like to promote language like checking your blood sugars as opposed to testing your blood sugars because of all the test anxiety that kids have these days. We felt like if we said checking, it promoted kids to actually check their sugars more, not feeling like they would fail, like if they were to fail a test. So we like to talk about having blood sugars in range, and if a blood sugar was out of range, not being upset by the number, but thanking them for checking and figuring out what we needed to do with that information. Same goes with when blood sugars were in range. We didn't want to reward blood sugars for being in range. We wanted to say, great, how does that make you feel? So things like that we worked on in our training week to make kind of our best staff team possible for the 8 weeks of the summer. And then next thing that you always have to think about is where your camp's going to run and what activities are going to be there. So with DCAMPS, we actually don't own any of our facilities, but we believe that we want to have a regular, authentic camp experience, so we partner with camps that do this and own their facilities. So we partnered with YMCAs that, you know, ran activities like canoeing, sailing, archery, high ropes, all of those types of activities that any Canadian summer camp would run. And we'd partner with them and work with them to facilitate what they were good on. So they would be the ones teaching sailing. And then our staff and our group would be the ones facilitating and dealing with child behavior management and the medical side of things. So, you know, that was how our partnership worked with our facilities. We did what we were good at, and we paid our facilities to do what they were good at. The next was registration and communication. So how do you sign up for camp? How do you know what's happening at camp? All of that fun stuff. So we were also fortunate enough to have an online registration system that we could specify what types of questions we could ask, what medical questions we had, everything beforehand. It's a really expensive system, but it worked well. It works well for us, and all of our medical teams got input on what types of questions we needed to know beforehand. So what medical information we needed to know, and then also we had our media consent waivers there, our liability release forms, everything so we were safe on our end in case anything happened with our campers. And then communication, our camp team worked pretty hard on having a detailed communication plan. So our camp families were informed on what they need to pack, what they need to expect, who they need to call if they have any questions or concerns. Something that I always found interesting was that, you know, a lot of these parents have never let their kid be away from their home. They've never let their kid be on a sleepover before. So for them to drop their kid off at camp for a week and have no communication whatsoever with them was always a pretty stressful moment for them. So we tried to have communication and marketing materials in place so they knew, like they understood what was going to happen, and so that they could feel safe and trust us with that. Yeah, and then the next thing is at the end of camp, we always evaluate the program and make reports. So we would make SurveyMonkey questionnaires and send them to all of our camp participants and family camp participants and leadership development camp participants at the end of every program to understand what we need to work on by a programming perspective, by a facility perspective, if there's things about the facility that weren't good and we maybe needed to move facilities or whatever that may be. But then also that is where we could measure the actual impact of camp and what it meant in terms of how they were going to live, what their self-esteem was going to be like after they were done the program. And from there, and from those surveys, and we worked with our fundraisers on designing those surveys, we then would make reports to give to our fundraising team so they could essentially sell camp. And then the cycle begins all over again. So though I know that's really broad and kind of had generally touched on each of those subjects, but if you have any questions on more of the specifics of any of those, feel free to talk to me. I've been working with DCamps for the last 13 years and full-time for the last 3 years running 4 of these camps. So I'm just ask me any question you would like. I'd be more than happy to go in depth and be more than happy also to share some of the resources that we have. And then the last is, you know, camp is a lot of work and it's kind of a big undertaking. But it's definitely worth it. So I just want to share a little story, and then I'll read a quote about from one of the parents. But this summer, I had the opportunity to work with a girl from a really, really small community in northern Canada, in an Aboriginal community of about 50 people. And I was contacted by a healthcare professional to have this girl come to one of our programs. If you notice from our map, we have no camps in the northern part of Canada, so they actually fly down to our programs. So working with her healthcare team, her social worker, the ministry, and her family, we actually got her to come to camp. And it was the first time that she had ever met anyone else living with diabetes, let alone 150 people. She came to one of our bigger camps. And she, during the 2 weeks that she was there, she learned how to count carbohydrates. She was more accepting of her disease. She switched from mixed insulin to glargine and fast-acting insulin, and she had a plan of how she was going to take her insulin. Before coming to our program, she was hospitalized once a month for diabetes ketoacidosis, for not taking her insulin because she didn't have the support system at home. After camp, I got a note just last week or the week before from her social worker saying that she hasn't been in the hospital since the program happened. And that was at the beginning of July. So that, like, they wanted her to come to camp so that it could save her life. And this far in, it has. So we're happy about that. And then another parent quote, I'll just end with this. Our daughter loves camp, and we love how happy she is when she comes home. DCamps is an environment of sameness, acceptance, support, compassion, understanding, camaraderie, and so many other faucets that create a utopia for our children. DCamps is such an amazing opportunity and a blessing, and it is a life. It is life-changing for these kids and families. I recommend it to every parent and child I meet in the Type 1 community. So thank you, and let me know if you have any questions.
Okay, thank you very much. We will have discussion at the end because
okay, we'll do the question at the end. Okay.
About the schedule. So now Irina Vlasenko will speak about her experience about Eurocamps together with Christina Petrut.
Hello everybody. But for start, I think you need fresh. Stand up, please. Pedro, maybe you can help me. Come on. Pedro, come on. Come on.
I would suggest just to close your eyes to the camera.
Not too much time in the evening. I think after this we can listen to me. Let me introduce. First of all, I would like to say thank you, my friend Dario. Of Of course, a lot of emotions, but it's always tough.
But yesterday we said that we will have coordinators for physical activity during coffee breaks, and nothing happened. So I would kindly ask again to nominate coordinators for having at least stretching during coffee breaks. Okay?
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Hello again. First of all, I would like to say thank you to organize committee and my friend Dario who invite me as speaker. I very appreciate that I can share my experience with you. I am Irina Vlasenko from Ukraine. I'm a board member of IDF Europe, and we are happy that 2 days ago we was elected for new term. And in this case, we can collaboration, I'm sure. And I have big experience from Ukrainian Diabetic Federation. Ukrainian Diabetic Federation is a long, it's an organization who member of IDF from 1996. Of course, I was not involved in that time, but anyway, we have a big experience, especially for a youth camp, for not many children, but for youth, for young people, also for adults, it's a lot of different experience. I try to be short, maybe I have chance to show some video, it's like historical video, but in the end of our presentation after the Christina, if it's work. I will try to be short. I'm sure that you know many aspects. Somebody organized camp, but little. It's very good. I'm also association professor in a medical academy. I know exactly that need repeat, and finally we remember something. First start. Who will
manage? Danielle, maybe you can. But there is a pointer somewhere there.
Need instruction, you see. By the camp, and a very important camp for youth, for even for adult people. Now you cannot imagine, but this it's true. How which goals we can touch? Attaching public attention to the problem of diabetes, promoting a health well way of life among the population, educating, involve people to diabetes movement. It's very important. We must have team for your activity. Psychological adaptation of children and teaching communication. Active interest in social life. Organizing clubs for very interesting. Improving the quality of life people of really, real people in real life. Which step? How you think? Which first, what need for first? Excellent. Another set. What need for first? How you think? Come on, quickly. Answer. For start need idea. Then you need big, greatest wishes. Without your wishes, nothing happened. You must have team. You must have skills. And look, I especially write because somebody better reading than listen me, and also this is the presentation I give and you can share. Driving up a plan of the event and its budget with clear deadline and accountable for founding. The preparation of team with volunteers and payment for the work. The leader of the camp is responsible for everything. You are leader, you are responsible for everything. So you must know every aspect personality, trust by verify. The choose and preparation of location and contact with necessary people must be in time because everything takes time and maybe something happens and we cannot manage. Start earlier as possible. People in camps must be selected, taken into account your social characteristic and severity of this disease. All questions, Mamma mia. All questions must be agreed beforehand. For example, type of pharmaceutical participants and media coverage. Without abandoning the plan, we must be ready to change the plan during the course again. This must be plan B, you know, about this idea. If you cannot match like this way, but you must have another plan, not in moment open this. It's very important to analyze the result of camp for improvement next year, to give information to the media, to say thank you partnership, partner, sponsor. It's very important. You know, every good words is very pleasant. To organize medical assistance. I would like highlight cross line all these things. It's very, very important. Sometimes we, I remember as me, it's need be funny, it's need be very interesting, but forgot about these things. This is very, very important, because if during your camp, this will be very nice organized, something happens, it's cross your, destroy your work. Also, it will be big, bad image. In this case, optimum team is Daniela say, one doctor, nurse is possible, and educator. You can use your research, reserve like participants who will be participant in camp, but for example, who nurse help to doctor, this is possible. With respect to supervisor of, this is very important, we use this for our camp. We use experience from Great Britain Association. We have one camp who have teenager and young people. Young people, five teenager, one young people like responsible, like small group. It's big camp, but one person exactly must look for five teenagers or children. But for children, it's very, if we listen about the children camp, must be also some adults who are responsible. Look, must be medical assistant and first aid. It's extremely important. The Ukrainian Diabetic Federation always trains the educator for camps and the lecturer of the School of Self-Managed Schools. Also very important our experience that the physical health of patient is very important. A condition of participant must be that diabetes has to be compensated without acute condition and serious complication. We have some experience. Some person from Kazakhstan come to us and we see she is not good compensate. And we try do something for prevent. Thanks God, we have not, but it's very close for something happens. We used camp for education. Every camp include elements, depends on what this camp, what's idea. But for children and young people, it's not necessary lecture. Better role play, the bites, peer-to-peer training, and now we have new term like edutainment. This is education through some presentation like funny, like role. Also, that's all. Also, necessary to teach teenagers and young people to communicate. Because often children and young people are isolated from society. I think you feel same before, but now you're very strong, you're more confident, and you can share this experience. It is necessary to rid them of any interiority complex. They must feel self-confident. This is guy from Kazakhstan or Uzbekistan, I don't remember, Uzbekistan. And after our camp, teacher or coordinator tell me, plane they can do insulin without secret. It's more confident. This is very important. We not make secret, because I think I have diabetes many years, and for start of course I make secret from this. But why? many people have a different disease. Not make secret, because it depends of us. If we make secret, somebody's, oh, it's something wrong. Please, be sure. Так, and everybody speak about successful, but I would like share negative experience for prevention. The behavior of children can sometimes be troublesome. Something there is desire to do wrong things. The role of leader is vital, especially among young people. You are leader. You influence on people, and please be strong for this. For example, because some people thinking, oh, let's go to drink, but it's very easy way be popular, but it's wrong way. And you will see that after this some period, you cannot manage something. It will go out from your control. In this case, right direction. And also we have experience, it need be very strong for punishment. We have experience in our camp that one guy's drinking, and it's extremely nice guy who involved in our organizing committee, but drinking. And our chair of Ukrainian Diabetic Federation decide take away him. It nobody believe, but he said, no, we have rules, go out. This case, many people don't understand. You know, it's like catastrophe per person. But need follow for rules. In this case, you for start, you must exactly explain in. If something happens, please, you go home. Also, another problem is the harmful habits of the participants, alcohol or smoking. You cannot manage like father and mother, please stop it. But exactly explain rules. You can, but you can if you want, you cannot participate in our camp. And for ending, we propose a solution for this problem in the camp. Make prohibits of alcohol and smoking a condition on participation. Okay, we cannot stop smoking, for example. But it's not like officially go to for start and smoke. No, if you want, nobody see. Okay. Punish violence of the rules, I say. Carefully select leaders of educator and teach. Keep the participant busy through the all day. This is very important. If like your camp, if you're busy, you cannot thinking about another things like drinking and smoking. You have no time for this. So I think it's enough. Another you can read. Thank you so much for your patience and attention.